Is there anybody like too sweet for to ever have a crossword cross their lips?
Sissy Spacek.
Sissy Spacek is true.
Hmm. Although, yeah, she got tipsy in New York.
No.
Did she?
Did any of you know each other before starting on this particular journey?
Mark and I did.
Hughes and I did.
Stephen and I did.
Sharon and I have done, how many have we, three?
I know, we've done three films
all
together.
All the films we work on win the NAACP award. I've worked on five.
Yeah. Wow, you've outdone me.
Mark and I met in our early 20s as production assistants on J. Crew photo shoots. Hmm. Literally.
Wow.
It's true.
You still get a discount?
No.
Just asking.
He modeled the boxer shorts.
You did too.
Well, I did the socks.
Socks. So were you in New York? Were you in
yeah.
LA?
I was in New York. Ricker was in New York. I was a PA on Beavis and Butthead. And Moon was moonlighting as a J. Crew PA.
And what do you do as a PA on Beavis and Butthead?
Well, I lasted 2 weeks because
not much, clearly.
I had an opinion. And I didn't understand why we were making these copies that just kept getting thrown away, and I was fired.
So
I learned that PAs do not ask questions. You just do your job. They didn't last long.
And what did you want to be doing?
I didn't know. I moved to New York to, I'd sold jet fuel in Memphis, Tennessee, and then I wanted to get in the entertainment industry. So that was my first gig, my short-lived gig. But the die was cast.
It just was attractive to you?
Yeah, I just wanted to be in the storytelling business. I didn't know how I was going to plug in. So that was my first gig.
So it could have been movies, it could have been theater, it could have been television, it could have been...
I didn't know. I knew I was interested in writing, acting, and directing, and I just didn't know which one would... I didn't know which one I would really love, mm-hmm. So I kind of started doing all of them, and then I finally came to L.A. and did the Groundlings program. And they all became commingled, and now they kind of all blend in as the same art form for me. They all go together.
Yeah.
You have to know how to act and write and direct. You have to know how to direct to be able to act and write and all of it. So they all go together for me now.
And when did the first inkling of the help come to you?
My friend Catherine Stockett wrote the novel. She had been telling me about it for 5 years, but was very shy about letting me read it because she was insecure about it. Mm-hmm. Didn't know what people would think, didn't know what she had done, and didn't know what was going to happen. And after she'd gotten her 60th rejection letter, she finally said, "All right, you can read it. Tell me what's wrong with this material." And I read it and told her that those were 60 idiots and this is beautiful and I want to make it into a film. And so I got the rights from her before it was even a book. Hmm. Wasn't even published. She didn't have a publisher yet. So
wow.
So what were the odds of it ever becoming a film at that point?
I didn't know. I'd never had odds. I was like, oh, well, I'll try this now. So no, but when I started adapting it, it was just me and an unpublishable manuscript and just passion to tell the story that I knew, that I kind of grew up around in Mississippi. And it was the first time I'd ever understood what it was to be truly passionate about something you wanted to create. It's when I understood what it took to really go that extra mile, and it was her source material.
Hmm. So how long was it before there was a realistic chance of this actually happening? And you hiring all these folks?
Well, I got the rights in May of 2008 and finished the script by that Christmas. And then the book came out the following February, mm-hmm. and became a huge hit. And then I spent a year with people calling me saying, "What do you want to do with this? Who are you? What are your intentions? I want to make the movie. What do you really want to do with this?" And so that went on for about a year. And then finally, DreamWorks stepped up at the table in February 2010.
So was that a fight, or was that just a given that you were going to do it?
There was never a fight. It was complete stubbornness and just saying, no, I'm doing this.
You gotta do it.
So does that help Tate directs as well? Complete stubbornness or?
No.
No.
Collaborative. No. You gotta be collaborative.
Not at all.
Very collaborative.
Yeah.
Very.
So how did you choose this particular group of people?
Our shoes, I think.
Shoes. No, it was, I'm very personality driven. I mean, really, I called Ricker first. I said, I got the right to this book that's not out yet, and I've written this screenplay, and I want you to be the production designer. He's like, oh, God. I need you to come to Mississippi. We need to find these locations, and he did. And then I met Steven, and it's personality. Chris Columbus introduced us, and I'm really personality driven. If I feel like I can break bread with somebody, same with casting. I don't mean this in the wrong way. Their resume is almost second. But luckily, these resumes were amazing. And Hughes was a Southerner. His dad was a bit of a cool cat in the civil rights movement.
Yeah,
civil rights activist.
North Carolina.
And we really bonded on the knowledge. And then Sharon made jambalaya, and I knew she was from Louisiana. And we talked about her family. And Stephen said that he's kind of a Southerner, South Africa.
That works.
Really, it's personality driven, and everybody here had a true vested interest in the material, and it wasn't just a job; they wanted to be a part of it.
So, in your guys' vast experience, which you have, is that when things work better? Does having a family on a set and having it be kind of something that works personality wise, what makes a movie end up working out pretty well?
Yeah, by far.
By far, you feel familiar with everybody. You know, you can. You're not hiding anything or your personality. You're who you are.
It was, you know, this film, I've said this many times, but this film was, for me, as far as the group of people go, hands and heads and tails above every other film. I mean, it was fun. We had a great time. I was on location, which was rare. I don't usually go on location anymore. I mean, the editors don't go on location as much as they used to. And it was fun. I mean, it was hard. Especially for, it was harder for them than it was for me, but I mean that they managed to shoot 160 pages.
52
in the time that was allotted. It was remarkable. It really, I never ceased to be amazed that they got through it, and it's.
Nor do I.
I know you did. And they survived.
Poor Sharon.
And that wouldn't have happened if they're.
And our budget. These poor guys with their budget.
Yeah, their shoestring budget.
Mark's cutting out stars out of crate paper for the ballroom part.
I called Panavision and I said, what's the cheapest cameras you've got left?
Really?
Yeah.
Pretty much.
There was no budget. I mean, it really was not much of a budget. Yeah. You know,
that's the literal truth.
And what did they say?
They said, well, we've got an old this and an old that, and you know, no, people aren't using these very much. And I said, you got a crane in
how
the
old
same
was,
category?
How old was that crane that you used?
50s.
The crane was invented in the 40s. I used it that's kind of 20 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And because we didn't have any money, I called Chapman. Well, Charlie, our key grip, called Chapman on our behalf, and Mr. Chapman is still a wonderful, alive guy. He made the originals, and we asked, do you still have any of those great Titan cranes we used on Lethal Weapon, you know? And he said, yeah, I got one in a warehouse in New Orleans, you can have it.
It's got cobwebs on.
And it was beautiful, and it was like, it was in the style, it made you, because you couldn't do these fancy things like you can do with modern cranes, it was an advantage, it was just great.
But completely coincidental in a way.
Yes.
Wouldn't have happened if it weren't for...
But it's serendipity. But the serendipity of meeting Tate and Hughes and Sharon and Mark, all of us had that feeling all the time.
Mm-hmm.
We were shooting a scene that's not in the movie. But
which one?
There's 12 of those.
No. And there was a railroad track at night.
Oh,
and
damn
I
it.
Said, I said to Tate, God, wouldn't it be great if we could afford to have a train go by? And we're shooting, and just as we rolled, I said, wait. I said, don't call action. Because I could see a train coming, you know, right through the middle of the scene. It was beautiful.
So do you, when the budget issue was initially an issue,
oh, it was never an issue. It was a mandate.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, was it a mandate that DreamWorks say, okay, we want to make this movie, we want to make it at this price, and that's it?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Pretty much.
And then everybody came on board after that and said, okay, we can figure out how to do this, or?
Well, we had to.
We had to.
We had to.
And I have to say, I understand their number. This was not supposed, what happened was not supposed to have happened. Especially with me at the helm on paper.
But the cast is not exactly what you would expect to be a low budget cast either.
No, but they're no huge stars. You know, I mean, maybe they will be, but and they, you know, some like a lot of films like this, they responded to material.
These women all wanted to be in the material, and to the fact where there are some high budget actresses that were stalking me, and it was actually quite weird. When they want to meet you, go, I don't want to meet them. I have an idea for the cast. No. But no, that was not an issue with the cast at all.
Well, was that easy? Was it easy? An easy selection for you, ultimately?
The cast?
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's pretty remarkable. I got pretty much everybody I wanted.
So what was the crappy part of this? Because you guys all seemed really happy.
There wasn't one.
There wasn't.
I mean, it was hard.
The heat. Say the heat.
Well, the physical nature.
Yeah, the physical nature
of shooting in the summer in Mississippi is not to be underrated.
And we shot a lot.
It was 107. I mean, it was hotter than hell, man. It wasn't just hot.
Right.
I mean, it was so hot. They had to get Cicely Tyson up before dawn to shoot her scenes she would survive.
As the summer approached, and I realized that this was going to get very bad indeed, I went to...
Yeah, Stephen had us up at 4 a.m.
Our assistant director said, what do you think we all get up, you know, 4 a.m., start shooting as the sun hits at 7? Mm-hmm. And he says, but that means I've got to get the actors in at 3. And I said, well, it's better 3 a.m. than be doing the same stuff at 3 in the afternoon when it's 110, 114 degrees and the light's terrible and you actually will die, literally.
It was brutal.
It was brutal.
We lost 8 people.
And what was the biggest challenge for you, Sharon? Sure, the heat was not so great for costume.
The heat, I've got to say, I don't know. I mean, I had this... cast these amazing women who just totally agreed on everything I wanted to do. Cause I love the book and I love the screenplay so much. I just think I channeled with them the same thoughts, and Tate and I did. And
I'd say the biggest challenge, you had a lot of really cool choices for all the costumes, which made it hard to pick.
Yeah, I think
she overworked.
And I had an amazing... I made most of the costumes in LA, but the person who was making them loved the story so much. He was half pricing me on all the clothes. So I was not in such a bind with my made to order, because he was just loving it every minute.
We should quit propping up these low budget movies.
Oh no, it was really hard.
It was horrible.
And did you have to cut out a moviola? Was that the required?
No, I didn't have a moviola. I had a bright light and some scissors. And I would, just strip. And Tate would come in and we'd,
and a guitar.
I think that one's going to work. We couldn't hear sound. Couldn't afford sound until the end. Yeah.
So what was the decision to be on the set for you? How did that happen?
I don't really know what the process was, but it was so great. I think it's a lost art. You know, there were a lot of lost arts that we did on this movie, including the crane. Mm-hmm. But we watched dailies every day, which people don't do anymore. And,
I just have to have that.
But it's great for everybody, because you sit there and you watch it. Not only do you watch it communally, but people can talk. I get a sense sitting next to Tate, he tells me what he likes. And you see it projected for the first time. Because now I don't see it projected until maybe the preview. Mm-hmm. So I see, it's not big, but it's bigger than it is in my editing room. And it makes a difference, the location you watch dailies in. And you're watching it with a group of people, asked if you would experience in the theater. And it was, it was cool. I mean, people got to watch it together. And also, I think it can't be underestimated the value of people seeing their work and making adjustments mm-hmm. if there's issues, mm-hmm. you know. But we had a lot of sound issues because there were a lot of cicadas.
it was
the 7-year itch for the
cicadas.
I was hitting trees, seeing if I could make them shut up. You know, like, they would not shut up, and they were, I mean, they were loud. They were really,
really loud.
Yeah. And seeing the dailies is part of your thing, Stephen?
Yes. Well, I mean, I started work in England shooting and did at Pinewood Studios, mm-hmm. and they would show dailies to the whole crew at 8 in the morning, unsung, wet, straight from the lab, and everybody was invited, the director and the DP, and there would be, say, a few in this enormous theater, mm-hmm. twice the size of the DJ theater here. Mm-hmm. And at least, and you'd see yesterday's work. And then you go straight from there at 8:15 to the set. And mm-hmm. so if you, whatever you weren't getting or whatever could be improved or, you know, you could, it's this immediate feedback. It's beyond me how people make movies now and sit in their hotel rooms with little DVDs and think that this is what they're getting.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, and also it's this question of collaboration. It's I can feel when Tate likes it. I can also feel when he doesn't. He can feel the same with me. If there's a focus problem, we find out then and there while we have the actors, the set, mm-hmm. the memory, everything. We can fix it. We can, you know, all these things. It's nuts that
we did not have one reshoot.
No,
I meant once we got back to LA.
No, once we got back to LA.
Nothing.
Of course, anything that needed to be reshot, whether it's focus, color, performance, everything, everybody involved had seen it. It was there. It wasn't going to go away. And we were in the scene.
Did the actors come to the daily?
I later found out it's not normal.
No.
I like writing and I like acting and I think it's really important to a film, and I wanted my actors to know what movie we were all making. So when actors would show up, I would bring them in Hughes and I would show them a lot of the movie.
I still
don't know why that's weird. I think everybody should, it's part of collaboration.
Right,
everybody should
absolutely.
Know the movie mm-hmm. they were making. And I remember Sissy Spacek came in, Jessica Chastain came in, and I would show them scenes cut together. And they would all say, this is what we're doing. I'm going to my room right now. I'm going to work on my work.
No, I know, you know, it was amazing because I've never had this experience before. But there was somebody in almost every night. And because the footage was looking so great, it was, mm-hmm. they were like blown away. And I think in particular, I don't know if it was Tate's plan or not, but Viola was so amazing that people would come in and we'd show scenes with Viola and they were going, uh-oh.
I got to get my game on.
I got to get ready, you know. But it was
amazing
great.
To see. It was amazing to see, to
it
be in the room
was.
That
and
night when these
the
actresses would.
I mean, Mark, everybody came
I know, I'd come yeah. running up at the end of the day.
And it did, and even if you were so exhausted you couldn't stand up, to see dailies or to see a cut scene was inspiring. It was... And we were all working together. It was an intensely collaborative and wonderful experience.
So was there a lot of stuff going on with Viola that you wouldn't necessarily see on the stage or on the set?
What do you mean?
That there were a number of actors of her caliber, because it's very high, where people talk about seeing them working on, you know, in front of the camera, and you don't quite see the magic happening on the set. But then you see it on the film.
Oh, you see it when she's in the lunch line. You see it when you're rehearsing. You see it when she's in the yard getting ready. She does her scene. Everybody's crying. You
can't
forget
breathe.
To turn the camera off.
No. You can't breathe.
She is, no, you are always aware of her power.
It was another
period.
Great thing about dailies because, you know, we'd watch some scenes with Viola and not only were they all amazing, but it was so easy to pick takes that way.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, we're in the editing room. It's different. You know, it just is. Because she would just blow you away. And then there would be, oh, that's amazing. And then the next one.
Oh, wow.
That's pretty amazing.
But not just Viola. All these women. Yeah, I mean, Janny to everybody.
They were all great.
But there isn't a weak one. I don't think.
Not at all.
Tate did an amazing job. Casting
yeah,
it's a big part of why the film is so successful.
So do you feel that all the way through as you're shooting it? Did you feel it before you started? Did you? Was there a moment where it became clear that something other was going on here?
I was aware something different was happening at rehearsal.
I was sold by the screenplay. I was simply sold. I was blown away. I felt as if Tate had secretly gotten near my grandmother and knew all of her friends. This whole story just really, it grabbed me. But then the casting of these women, they were so amazing. They're just so high caliber talent. I'm an acting major, and I just was felt like, oh, I'd never tell them. they were actresses, you know, they weren't and celebrities, they were just actresses.
And they were all so supportive of each other. Everybody's ego,
it was such a family,
was in check, and people, actresses wouldn't be working that day, and they would come to watch scenes being filmed the next day because they just didn't want to be away from the process, which was really, really cool.
Nobody wanted to be away. Yeah. Everybody came down to Greenwood that summer. Mm-hmm. The people from the studio came down multiple times.
Four times.
Yeah.
and it was fun.
And there was no problems. They just didn't want to leave. It was great.
Not to beat us up, as you usually when the mob arrives. it's bad news, but it wasn't like that at all.
They wanted to come to be a part of it. Truly. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was kind of amazing.
And how much rehearsal was there? You were talking about rehearsal before. Steven, you started
2 weeks, 3 weeks?
It was 3 weeks. But in the morning, say we'd rehearse, and then in the afternoon, location scout and
fittings.
Yeah.
And you know, but everything. But the thing is, I'd experienced rehearsal on location and on set before films. Again, it's something that's not done much.
Right.
And I just know it's the cheapest way to get a film on its feet and so I said, Tate, please. Do it.
Now I'm screwed because I have to do it. But it was amazing because these actors were often in the practical locations where Mark had already kind of have designed what he was going to do. So it was much like theater. We kind of pre-planned what we were going to do. And then people like Allison and Bella were like, I want to pick this up. And I want to walk this way. And you got to do that. And plan, and it was just, and especially the writing. The script maybe was 162, but after rehearsals, I was like, I don't need that. That's gone.
And how much of the movie was shot in practical locations?
Oh my gosh, we built three sets, and yeah, that's it.
I'd say 90% of the film.
So Minnie's, that's pretty unusual. Also,
Stein's office.
Minnie's Abilene and three Steins.
Oh yeah.
Mini sets.
That's right.
Yeah, very mini sets.
On a free warehouse that was not a soundstage.
In a cricket field.
In a cricket.
Motherfuckers.
I just had to say that.
So how much more difficult was that? Was it more difficult for you to find everything and to put it together?
It was not difficult to find everything because it was all there. It was shooting on a backlight. I mean, that was one of the, you were saying it was the script. I mean, for me, I think a lot of things, when we went down to Greenwood that week before Christmas 2 years ago, and we rolled up to this house that eventually became Skeeter's house, and it was like it jumped right out of the pages of the book. I mean, it was, I've said this, that it was as if there was one perfect version of everything that we needed. I mean, they weren't just handed to us on a silver platter, but they almost were. I mean, we had to do some searching
and
for some of the
credit,
stuff.
And to his credit, he didn't just walk in and put a tulip in a vase. He had to, no, because in the South, where I'm from, everybody's house has the same old shit and the same new stuff, and he had to really work hard to create an appropriate difference between all these locations. He did an amazing job, and it's so seamless that it looks like this exactly like they'd always been.
But it wasn't. I don't think there was a single interior that you didn't change.
No.
And not for the love of just changing. I mean, they were unsuitable in that they'd been modernized, or they were ugly, or they were not in character, but the bones of the rooms and the way everything worked was wonderful. And they were old houses, and it fit.
And how much of a challenge was that for you? I mean, you had to Were you shooting fast in this movie, or did you?
Oh my God!
He used to weigh 300 pounds. So he had
it's a challenge to how many pages a day? Then, I mean, we were doing 3 or 4 pages a day, and a few things I asked Tate, beg, rehearsal, and don't do more than 2 takes because that's how we'll get momentum.
Huh. And I always like working fast. Actors like it. Yes. They get hooked on it. Mm-hmm. They love knowing that they've got 2 or 3 and you do it and you go. But like I said, I love the acting and the writing, and so everybody around me, I gotta give this guy tons of credit. I mean, this is my first big studio film, and I just often would look at Steven and go, okay. This is what I'm getting from these actors, and this is the emotional intent. And Steven's like, all right, we figure it out.
So you got out of the 103 degrees eventually, came back to LA, went on with your other jobs, maybe, and other things going on. When was there the sense that, when did you all see the movie for the first time? Did you see it assembled before it was publicly shown? Did you?
Oh, these guys, like, or who you speak? Yeah.
Well, I mean, you'd see it a few times, maybe.
You didn't see it with an audience. You saw it when it was 2 hours and 50 minutes.
Yeah, I saw it with 2 friends of mine.
Yeah.
Let come in, and we sat in the dark room. And
I don't think we'd even watched the whole thing at that point, had we? It was too much to get through.
It was so much.
When I started a recut this summer that the film was 90 minutes, and it was, you know, it was like a commercial. You know, this, the first cut was 3 hours and 5 minutes. You know, it was like, it was unbelievable. And a lot of great stuff. There were no bad scenes in the movie.
I knew. I made the request. I said, I want to see the longest version that this movie will ever be. Because I knew it was going to get shorter, but I wanted to see it all because it was all great.
So what were you finding in recutting as you're going from 3 hours to an hour and a half?
Well, I mean, as Tate will gleefully tell you, I was freaked out.
He was so freaked out.
I was freaked out in Mississippi.
Before we started filming, he's like, you got to cut this script down.
I was, you know, I for one could not believe we were going to Greenwood, Mississippi with a 155-page script. And how they were going to get, I mean, it is a miracle that they shot it. I mean, that they got it all shot. It's a miracle
that then Tate persuaded DreamWorks to let him put out a 2-hour, 20-minute.
We never thought it would be. I thought I had to get it down to
210, you kept 210 saying.
Or I was kept thinking 210 or 2. And finally, we were 240 at 7 weeks into the director's cut. So we had 3 weeks after that. And DreamWorks did something that was really smart. They told us we could go and have a preview, a recruited preview, NRG preview.
Before they saw anything.
They hadn't seen, and they wouldn't
come. It was just Hughes and I had seen anything.
They wouldn't come. They said we won't come. And they didn't score it because they were afraid. I mean, I think that, you know.
As were you.
As was I. Yeah, yeah, no, for sure. And
there's a lot of that.
Yeah. And I think, I don't know what their motives were, but part of it was a wake-up call, for sure, if we were in trouble. And so we went to Kansas City at 2:40, and it blew the audience away.
400 people, yeah.
It was unbelievable, and that changed. My life was very different after that. Then it was just a matter of trying to trim and get it down.
Nuance it.
Yeah.
When did DreamWorks do it?
Same situation. They
second preview.
They agreed that I wanted them to see it with an audience, and we went to Pasadena.
A tough place. Yeah.
That's a tough town.
And it was about 2:35 that version. And DreamWorks came, and it was the first time to see it, and that one did get scored. And they were really pleased with the audience reaction, and then as we were talking about some things that might be an issue or a problem, they came and handed the score to Stacy at DreamWorks, and she literally went, holy fuck. And then Hughes was like, oh, she goes, holy fuck. And
scored through the roof.
Yeah.
It's like, they were still looking before they saw the score. They were still looking like, well, it played well. The audience really reacted, and then the score shows up.
She's like, hold on. And then it was really cool, because that's when DreamWorks and Stacy Snyder, she said, now let's just get really greedy and see how great we can all make it. And so we just kept nipping and tucking and surgically just massaged it and did some more screenings, and that was it.
It was tougher at that point to get it down, because we were, you know, we were losing.
And he was amazing. We literally, the only thing we argued about was what to have for lunch one day.
Well, that's when you went on a diet.
Yes. Yeah, so, but he was just great. I mean, like I said, I mean, this is only as good as the people I've been surrounded by, and we had the greatest working relationship, all of us. And we learned from each other. My naive ballsiness made you do things that you didn't want to do.
What Tate was.
And then he would say, "You can't." I'm like, "Okay, I get it." It was great.
I try not to say that. I don't think that's a good rule in the editing room to say you can't do that. I think you have to try. But I probably did say it more than once.
You would say, "Well, there was this one movie one time. He did it that way."
We tell stories a lot. But yeah, Tate was pretty. I'm sure it was the same experience with these guys. Is that he would let me do my job, and then he would come in and do his routine on it, whatever it might be, his analysis of it, and it just makes it more fun. You know, you feel more empowered to do your work rather than having somebody sitting talking to you all the time. And he always, you know, he's not a frame guy. There's a word for it that I'm not going to use that starts with an F. But he always had, in a way I didn't, especially after a while, because it's very difficult, he always had the larger picture involved, literally. And if we ever were starting to get a little this way or that way, he would bring us back on. And you know, that's one of the great things about the editing room. You learn, you think you know the film after it's been shot and you've got a cut together. Mm-hmm. But just by sitting there and talking about the footage as you're going through, I learn more and more what Tate was intending when he was shooting it. And you know, we try to aim it in that direction if we could. You know?
So when did you lock?
When did we lock?
Yeah. When was that? April something?
Yeah, I mean, we were, it was March, end of March.
Yeah, because I went into the DI then.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right.
So you're now waiting for an opening in mid-August. So are you thinking, wow, this movie can make $75 million at the box office?
No, I knew it was going to do better. I made a bet with my assistant. It was going to do over 100, and I won.
Did anybody have a bet that it was going to do over 150?
I didn't go that far.
Nope.
I think the hopes what the initial hopes was at best 65 domestic, 5 million foreign.
But after the first weekend, I wrote 200 down. But that was after the first weekend.
You couldn't help but be positive after being in the previews. I mean, the previews were incredible. I've never been in previews like that before. I mean, where people were crying and people were laughing, and it was a roller coaster.
Didn't want it to end. Wouldn't leave.
My assistant went to Chicago with the film when they were going to show it to, I think it was at least a 60% black audience.
No, it was 99.9%.
Was it
NAA? No. But they wanted to play before a black audience to see what the woman sat beside Heather and cried from the beginning until the end of the movie. It's a long movie, as you know. It's a lot of crying. And, you couldn't help but feel it was going to do well, you know, because of the audience's response. It was just a question of it playing, and it played a long time because it built, I think.
And as old pros, with a few of you, is it having done the work and feeling good about it at that point that satisfies, or is all of this that's happened since and the kind of rolling of the movie and getting bigger and bigger as it went along, does that make it even more exhilarating? And is that significant to you guys in that way?
I can only speak for myself, but you know, the experience was the best part of it. I mean, I wish every film could be like this, because they're not very often.
The problem for me is that having had such a wonderful time and then approaching other projects and realizing at the interview it's got to be nothing like this. it really is. And I've shot about 30 films theatrically. I've only had one other experience in all that time where I could say that I've had as strong a creative hit.
It was fun.
It was wonderful.
Yeah, for me, people ask me that question. I got asked it this morning about what do you think about the success? And the only way I can sum it up is, for me, there's two different movies at play here. There's what we did that was this intimate thing that was not supposed to happen, and that feeling of triumphant glory on October 13th when we finished.
Yeah.
We all knew we had something. We had a movie there. And then I'm so grateful for what's happened. But then the help, I truly have a hard time making it the same movie in my head.
Mm.
It's two different things.
Yeah.
It's, oh yeah, that's what we did. It's strange. I mean, a lot of that's,
I know what you mean.
When we had our final cut, I kind of was happy and a little melancholy that it was over, and it was over. So it's a weird sensation that this is still that movie, but it feels like it's something else. It's become something that we didn't really intend.
Because I always like, you know, these sort of screens. I like to go in and just look at a few minutes on the screen here with the, and it's a strange crowd and a strange room, and it almost feels like a strange
movie.
It's like something that happened to me a long, long time ago, and then I watch Skeeter and I watch everybody, and then it just comes back. Mm. And it's as if we would just wrap yesterday. It was an intense and important time for me.
Sounds like you guys are up for a reunion tour.
Yes.
I hope so.
Different kind of movie, maybe. But
yeah.
I know Viola wants to do a comedy more than anything. She wants to get her comic chops out there.
She's funny.
So can you imagine just doing that? Just like, okay, let's get the band back together and do something.
There will be no not, help.
There will be a help too, I assume.
No.
The helper.
No, but I mean, truly, in my limited experience, I always cast and crew up the people I like, and I want to work. Yeah, we all want to do this again. Very much so.
Yes.
Including all the actors. I mean, I'm writing something right now, and not everybody can be in it. It's just killing me.
Well, you can get to 162 pages.
No, this one's, I'm at 126, and it's going down.
Oh.